there lived an unusual gray-haired one. On the outermost isle dwelled he, and harm from him was never done, either on land or on sea. But sometimes mad sparks from his eyes would ignite when storm clouds above did appear. Then people whispered, "He's touched all right." And very few would, without fright, come Terje Vigen near. Once in a while I'd see him about, all laden with fish at the pier. White of hair he would sing and shout, and was full of youthful cheer. Still flirting with girls, whom he always adored, to the children he jested with glee. He'd swing his sou'wester and leap on board, hoist the foresail and shoot out the fjord, an old salt on a sun-swept sea. So now I'll tell you just what I've heard of Terje from beginning to end. And should it sound dry, do not be deterred. It's truthfulness you can depend. It's not just from him, but his friends of the deep, this remarkable story is told. From those who stood by and vigil did keep, closing his eyes to eternal sleep, when he died, nearly 70 years old. He was in his youth, wild and cocksure, early from parents he fled, and many a drubbing he had to endure as deckhand atop the masthead. Later in Amsterdam he jumped his ship, but homesick and now alone, sailed with Captain Prum on his homeward trip, and ended his seaman apprenticeship, back in Norway, now unknown. Tall, handsome, and sinewy, he'd become a well-dressed lad. But dead was most of his family, as well as his mother and dad. He brooded a day, well, maybe two, then brushed his sorrow aside. On solid ground, no peace he knew. It was better to build and live anew, on the waves, the wind, and the tide. A year thereafter, Terje was wed. A speedy ceremony. "He'll be sorry now," is what people said, to enter into matrimony. The dwelling he built became his mainstay, so winter was one of delight. It had windows that shone as the clearest day, with tiny curtains and flowers gay, their cottage red-painted so bright. With springtime thaw, when soft winds blew, in a brig Terje sailed away. In autumn, grey geese southward flew. He met them underway. Then fell on that sailor a weight nonplussed, for he felt young and strong. From lands of sunshine he had to adjust. Astern was a world of life and lust, but ahead was a winter long. They anchored the brig, and his shipmates took their shore leave to drink and carouse. He sent them a long and yearning look in front of his little house. Through the white curtains he looked inside and saw that two were there. Winding linen thread was his lonely bride, and healthy pink in a cradle beside, a laughing little girl so fair. They say that Terje's heart did find a new sense of purpose to keep. He worked and slaved, but was never behind in rocking his daughter to sleep. On Sunday evenings, when dance music rung wildly through the night air, the happiest songs at home he sung, while little Anna to him clung, pulling his wild brown hair. Now storm clouds of war were blowing anear in 1809. People still speak of that hardship year which was suffered through at the time. All ports were closed by English men of war, and crops failed due to a freeze. The poor went hungry, the rich heart sore. Two powerful arms meant nothing anymore. The result was death and disease. Terje brooded a day, well, maybe two, then brushed his sorrow aside. He remembered the friends that he once knew, the waves, the wind, and the tide. In these parts his memory is still alive, and from what folks say I will quote. When the wind had lost its strongest drive, Terje rowed so wife and child would survive across sea in an open boat. The smallest vessel he did obtain for crossing the Skagerrak blue, sail and mast would at home remain, his arms supplying the crew. He thought the skiff could do the chore if large waves abreast should churn. Bad were the reefs off Jutland shore, but worse was the English man of war, with eyes from topsail to stern. Sure of good fortune, he was outward bound. The oars flew over the foam. In Denmark he landed both safe and sound, bought the grain, and headed for home. God knows his cargo wasn't much worth, 3 barrels of barley, no more. But Terje had come from barren earth, where food and provisions were of great dearth. This would keep the wolf from his door. With raw-knuckled purpose for 3 nights and days, the strong man non-stop did persist. At daybreak the fourth, through the sun's rays, an outline emerged in the mist. It wasn't drifting clouds all aglow, but rugged mountain terrain, and high above all the ridges below was a well-known saddle-shaped landmark plateau. He had now made it back again. The cottage was now so close at hand, being just off his own home fjord. His heart felt elated at reaching land. He wanted to thank the good Lord. But his humble prayer would have to wait. He stared and was taken aback. Through the mist, a sight made him hesitate. A corvette appeared in the Hessness Strait, lying still with sails that were slack. A whistle was heard. He had been spied. The channel was blocked. What a scrape! But the favorable wind for the ship had died, so Terje tried to escape. A longboat was lowered down from the ship. He could hear the sailors sing. With heels to the boards, he took off at a clip, and over the water the skiff did skip, as blood from his nails did spring. The Gosling rocks underwater lie, east of a nearby sound. As in they roll, the swells break high, a depth 2 feet aground. The spray is white, but glimmers like gold, even in dead calm sea. Though the breakers are a sight to behold, the waves inside are small and controlled, mere ripples of harmony. Therein shot Terje Vigen's boat, like an arrow over water it flew. But right behind his wake with a gloat, rode 15 men of the crew. It was then he cried through the breaker's roar to God who was overhead, "Straight in there on that gravelly shore sit my wife and child in front of our door and with hunger wait for some bread." But 15 voices his prayer drowned out, as at Linger a triumph they'll boast, for English sailors these days could flout raiding the Norwegian coast. When Terje struck the reef on top, the longboat scraped bottom as well. From its stern, the officer shouted, "Stop!" Then with oar blade held up, ready to chop, through the skiff's floorboards it fell. The blow burst ribs, timber, and plank, and the sea poured in, gushing white. In 2 feet of water, the cargo sank, but it didn't sink Terje's spite. The well-armed men, he fought his way through. From the gunwale he jumped overboard. He ducked and he swam while they him did pursue. Though wherever he turned to evade the crew, he saw rifle, gun, and sword. They fished him up and on board did haul. The corvette shot a victory salute. From the poop deck emerged, proud and tall, her captain, 18 and astute. His first sea battle a skiff had won. Therefore his brazen mien. So the strong man did what last could be done, with prayers and tears to this Albion's son, on his knees on deck could be seen. He bought with tears, they sold with scorn, their usury was mock for prayer. Then a gale blew in from the east this morn, and southwest the ship did bear. Terje Vigen was still. There was nothing to do. His sorrow would be his own now. But his captors noticed something new. It was as if storm clouds no longer blew o'er his cheerless, overcast brow. On a prison ship many long years he spent, all of 5, they say, aboard. His hair turned gray, his neck was bent, from dreams of his home on the fjord. And these he hid. They gave him peace, a treasure to which he could cling. Then in 1814 the war did cease. Norwegian captives were given release. Home a Swedish frigate did bring. At his homestead pier, ashore he ran, a pilot with license to sail. But few recognize this grizzled old man who had rowed out so young and hale. His cottage now a stranger did own. Inside was the story he got. When the husband had left them all alone, they starved to death and were finally thrown in a common grave's unmarked lot. The years went by. He was a right busy one, guiding ships in and out expertly, and harm from him was never done, either on land or on sea. But sometimes mad sparks from his eyes would ignite when large breaking waves did appear. Then people whispered, "He's touched all right." And very few would, without fright, come Terje Vigen near. One moonlit night with a storm building swift, the pilots were all on alert. An English yacht off the coast was adrift, her sails all torn and inert. From the foretop a bright red flag did wave, a cry of distress outpoured. Tacking the wind, one boat assistance gave, pulled alongside, and it was a close shave, but the pilot got safely on board. He seemed so assured, this grizzled old salt. Like a titan he seized the wheel. The yacht obeyed, and its drift did halt, a vessel on even keel. A lord with lady, holding child secure, came astern and took off his hat. "I'll make you as rich as you now are poor, if asked from disaster you can ensure." The pilot the helm dropped at that. His face turned pale, his lips formed a smirk, like a smile breaking out somewhat. Straight to the rocks, then aground with a jerk, went the nobleman's splendid yacht.
"All to the boats! She didn't respond! My lord and lady with me! To splinters it will smash, but don't despond! I know a safe inlet just beyond! My wake your direction shall be!"
The phosphorescence flamed where the small craft sped towards land with its precious load. Astern stood a strong man steering ahead with eyes that scared and forebode. Leeward he glanced toward the Gosling's rough top, and windwards where once he did dwell. He let the helm and staysail line drop, swinging oar with blade up, got ready to chop, then through the boat's floorboards it fell. The sea gushed in all foaming white, and panic ensued on board. The mother lifted her daughter in fright as the waves around them roared. "Anna, my child!" she cried in despair. A shudder went through the old man. He took steering again, and leeward did bear. The boat sailed steady as a bird in the air. Through the storm and swells they ran. They went aground and sank atop the Gosling rock, secure behind the raging seas, and in this sunken boat the family stood in shock, all wet in water to their knees. "We're going to slide off! It's all been in vain!" his lordship cried in great fear. "The boat is safe, and so will remain, a sunken skiff with 3 barrels of grain is what supports us right here." A lightning flash of a half-forgotten deed across his lord's face did beset. He knew this sailor who with tears did plead for mercy on his corvette. The pilot he thundered, "My whole destiny you cast away for a claim. In just one moment, my revenge I'll see. The aristocrat then, on bended knee, begged pardon from Terje with shame. But Terje leaned on the shaft of the oar, like a young man with shoulders square, eyes glowing like coals as down they bore, the wind flowing through his gray hair. In your man of war you sailed well fed. I rowed my humble boat. I slaved for my family till nearly dead. You mocked my tears and took their bread. It was easy for you to gloat. Your lady is rich and fair as spring, smooth as silk her hand to see. My wife's hand was coarse from scouring, but at least she belonged to me. Your child has golden hair and eyes of blue, like a little angel indeed. My daughter was plain and not much to view. She was thin and pale, with a sickly hue, as poor folks' children in need. That was all my treasure on earth. It was everything I could call mine. It was riches to me of the greatest worth, but for you it was nothing so fine. And now, at last, is my vengeance day. I'm making you wait a spell for all those years of my prison stay, which bent my neck, turned my hair to gray, and shattered my world as well. He seized the child and swung her around. His left clasped the nobleman's wife. Go back, my lord, you must hold your ground, or it will cost you her life. In battle, his lordship tried to engage, but his arms were weak and slight. With burning lungs and eyes without rage, his hair at daybreak showed signs of old age. It had grayed in that single night. From Terje's face tranquility did beam. His breathing was calm as could be. He handed their daughter back with esteem, kissing her hands tenderly. He sighed as through an opened prison door. His voice was clear and steadfast. Terje Vigen is now as he was before. My blood till this moment like stones did pour. Revenge, revenge for the past. The stench in the hold of my prison ship stay was a terrible heartache to keep. Just like wilted straw, I afterwards lay, staring into a bottomless deep. But now it's all over, and even we stand. This promise I will not betray. I gave what I had and fell into your hand. If I have done wrong, you can justice demand from our Lord who made me this way. The crew was safe by morning's daylight, and the yacht had been towed ashore. They would rather not speak of events that night, but the name Terje Vigen did soar. The darkness of many a dream-tossed cloud can make one a storm night forget. Now Terje again bore his head straight and proud, which once long ago so lowly had bowed on the deck of an English corvette. To a cottage the nobles and crew did proceed, and many behind on the road. They all shook his hand in farewells and Godspeed as they stood in his humble abode. They thanked him for rescue from the storm wind's excess, for deliverance from rocks and despair. But Terje, he stroked the child's silken dress. No, what saved us all in our greatest distress was most likely the little one here. Swinging about to depart Hestnes Strait, the Norwegian flag flew from the yacht. Toward the Gosling the vessel did navigate, but now in salute fired a shot. And a glittering tear Terje couldn't restrain as he stared from a distant hill.
Great was my loss, but great was my gain. Perhaps what has happened has not been in vain. I thank thee, O Lord, for thy will. That's how I once saw him, around and about, all laden with fish at the pier. White of hair, he would sing and shout, and was full of youthful cheer. Still flirting with girls, whom he always adored. To the children he jested with glee. He'd swing his sou'wester and leap on board, hoist the foresail and shoot out the fjord, and all salt on a sun-swept sea. I saw a grave in the Fjære churchyard, exposed to the weather it stood, unkempt and uncared for, in full disregard. Its nameplate was black and of wood. It said, Terje Vigen, in letters of white, and the year he his final rest found. He lay in the wind, where the sun burned bright. The grass was therefore so stark at the sight. But wildflowers grew all around.